Learn Excel from Mr. Excel Podcast, episode 2241, Excel Hash. Will Bennu impact the Earth? Hey, welcome back to the Mr. Excel Netcast. I'm Bill Jelen. Something completely different today. And tip of the hat to Oz de Soleil for this great idea. He challenged six of your favorite Excel YouTube creators to a game called Excel Hash, right? And we signed up, collected ideas of ingredients that must be used in our solution, then used RAM between. And so all six of us have to post a video today where we have to use a 3D model, a form control, the frequency function, and max. Six competitors, all in a playlist. You, the viewers, get to vote for your favorite. Sounds like fun. The goal of Excel Hash is to take some random Excel elements and make something from them today. So, in the course of me using these four elements, here's what we're going to learn today. Well, our first ingredient today is the 3D model, and I love this 3D model. Whenever I do in my Excel seminars and I show insert 3D models, the example that I do in the seminar is Bennu. Alright, so Excel accepts any of these, FBX, Object, 3MF, Ply, STL, or GLB. You have to find one of those files. I have one of those here. So we'll insert, we get an object that we can resize. But not just rotate like this, we can do amazing rotations using this symbol. So now I can rotate Bennu in all dimensions. What is Bennu? Bennu is an asteroid. It is 0.3 miles across, that's 484 meters, and it's trapped in an orbit around the sun. It goes around the sun every 1.2 years. It is spinning wildly. A day on Bennu lasts just 4.2 hours on Earth. Astronomers discovered Bennu in 1999 when it passed 2.2 million miles away from Earth. Over the next 300 million years, there's a 48% chance that Bennu falls into the Sun, 26% that it hits Venus, 10% that it escapes the solar system after a close flyby of Jupiter, 10% that it hits us, the Earth, 3% Mercury, less than 1% for Mars and Jupiter. Well, hey, I love these free travel posters from Jet Propulsion Laboratory and NASA, this one advertising Earth. But unfortunately, I wish they wouldn't have sent one of these to Bennu, because Bennu is planning on making several close approaches to Earth. Astronomers have figured out these are the days when Bennu will be making a close pass. That one in blue, I love this one. They say it's going to be 300,000 kilometers away, which will put it between the Earth and the Moon. How wild will that be? And then these ones in red, these are the dangerous ones. Collectively, these dates in red, there's a 1 in 2700 chance that Bennu will impact the Earth. That sounds small, but it's not comfortably small. If every commercial airline flight had a 1 in 2700 chance of crashing, we would have 38 jetliners crashing every single day. It's kind of a big number. Now, what happens if Bennu hits the Earth? Does it kill everybody? No. You know, we don't know where it's going to hit the Earth. This is Meteor Crater National Landmark in Arizona. If Bennu were to hit right in the middle of Meteor Crater again, it would become three times as large and three times as deep. This circle, people within 3 miles of the strike, the wind speed will be 3,720 miles per hour. All buildings will be knocked down. The stuff ejected by the Bennu impact would cover 50 feet within this circle. Now, let's go out to 30 miles. Here, at 30 miles, people will experience an air blast of 156 miles per hour. Wood frame buildings would collapse, windows would be blown out, and everything would be covered in a half inch of dust. If you happen to be standing on a corner in Winslow, Arizona, it's not going to be a good day for you. Even the people on the outskirts of Flagstaff will be impacted. Now, out at a 300 mile radius, things won't be so bad. You'll actually hear the impact. It'll sound like a truck passing by the window, and there'll be a light coating of dust. But what if Bennu doesn't want to visit the desert? It's tired of desolate areas, and it wants to go where the action is, so it heads to Brooklyn. This is the 3 mile radius. Remember, all buildings within that circle are going to be toast. 30 miles, a majority of the tri-state area, the windows will be blown out. This will be a massive natural disaster. 300 mile range, hey, people in Pittsburgh, Cleveland, they're fine. Who is Ivan Yarkovsky and why do we care? He was a Russian civil engineer, 1844 to 1902. 2 years before his death, he wrote a pamphlet and he said, hey, look, if there is a daily heating of a rotating object in space, it might experience a force that, while tiny, could lead to significant long-term effects in the orbits of small bodies. Now, remember, Bennu is spinning fast. A day on Bennu lasts just 4.2 hours. As each side of Bennu rapidly heats and then cools, thermal radiation is causing a small but noticeable drift in the trajectory of Bennu. Observations of Bennu from 2.2 million miles away have estimated that the trajectory is moving about 282 to 286 meters per year due to this Yarkovsky effect. But hey, how can this matter at all? It's 2018 now, 2198, 180 years from now, times 282 or 286 meters, it's 50 kilometers, 31 or 32 miles. It's not going to miss the Earth. So, this term, accumulates quadratically, has been throwing me for a loop. All of these scientific papers say that the Yarkovsky effect accumulates quadratically. And I've been trying to figure out what the heck accumulates quadratically. Look, I'm not a rocket scientist. I'm not an astronomer. I can do VLOOKUP with my eyes closed, but I can't figure out the math behind these papers. Well, here, let's do it with VLOOKUP. Equal VLOOKUP of accumulates quadratically into my science jargon table, comma 2, comma false. The uncertainty in the future is a freaking large amount. Well, why didn't they just say that? And hey, big shout out, thanks to David Farnocchia at JPL for the email that pointed me to the exact page and figure in Dr. Chesley's 2014 paper. The issue is that this 282 to 286 meter per year compounds until the next near-Earth pass. In 2054, that distance from here to there will affect the future spin and trajectory of Bennu. And then, 6 years later, 2060, again, we have some uncertainty from 2054, more Yarkovsky, and then even more variability, and then 2080, and by the time we get to 2135, well, the uncertainty then is a path 49,500 miles, and it's not just a distance uncertainty, it's a time uncertainty. Think about it, the Earth is whizzing by, the Moon is spinning around the Earth, the delta in time and the delta in width here can dramatically impact what happens in those future visits in 2186 through 2198. The only reason they can say that it's not going to hit us in 2135 is because the error is within these bounds and it can't hit the Moon or the Earth. But after that, there's too many potential places where it can pass here, and location of the Earth, location of the Moon, it's a scattershot for the other passes in 2186 through 2198. All right, we're progressing. Next question, who is Dante Lauretta? This is Dr. Dante Lauretta talking about his spacecraft, OSIRIS-REx, asteroid sample return mission. Now, this is a picture of the spacecraft thanks to Lockheed Martin Space, and there are a series of instruments on the side of the spacecraft, including this one, the OSIRIS-REx Thermal Emission Spectrometer. OSIRIS-REx, launched on September 8, 2016, has been catching up to Bennu. It's going to arrive on December 3, 2018. In late August 2018, this is the first picture that OSIRIS-REx took of Bennu. It's about 2.2 million miles away, the same as ground-based operations were, and it's kind of shocking that the current Yarkovsky estimates are based on photos like this one. Between now and December 3, 2018, OSIRIS-REx is going to be able to improve from this photo to this photo. Michael Moreau, the OSIRIS-REx Flight Dynamic Systems Manager at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, explains it like this. Your commercial aircraft, if you fly across the country, is flying at 35,000 feet, about 10 kilometers. OSIRIS-REx will be 1.2 kilometers above Bennu taking pictures. They're going to create a complete topographic map of this asteroid. And again, back to Dr. Chesley. In his 2014 paper, he estimates that uncertainty, that 49,000 mile swath of uncertainty in 2135, might improve by a factor of 25. Now, I asked Dr. Lauretta when he expects that data to be back, and he says, well, they're going to collect the data during 2019, January through May, and July, June through August, but they won't actually probably have any final estimates until the OSIRIS-REx is on its way back to Earth. It's actually grabbing a bit of the surface, so we can study it here on Earth, and that's in 2021 through September 24th, 2023 is when it arrives. So maybe out in the 2021 period, we might see some improved estimates. But here today, for ExcelHash, let's see what we can generate in Excel. Now, hey, here's my disclaimer. Don't count on any of the science in the rest of the video. This is an Excel competition. I'm trying to blend the three remaining ingredients in ExcelHash to come up with an entry in an Excel game. From here on out, don't believe any of my science. I'll leave that in the capable hands of Dr. Chesley and Dr. Lauretta. I'm not a rocket scientist. I'm just Mr. Excel. So here's the model in Excel. We're going to start off with a paper from Dr. Chesley in 2014. He identified a series of 200 keyholes that if Bennu flies through this location in 2135, then there will be an impact with Earth in 2180. And these, some of these are really narrow, but some of these are really wide, like that one's almost 20 kilometers wide. Now, just to visualize this, from the minimum location to the maximum location, I've plotted all of these orange dots, and I've just arbitrarily assigned them as wide or narrow, so that way you can see the variability there. Now, bad science alert. In the interest of simplicity, I've assumed that there's a standard normal distribution between the minimum location and the maximum location. That's completely wrong, but I don't want this video to run to 17 hours. So, this blue curve is the probability. Here's Bennu. Bennu's going to hit somewhere. It's more likely to hit in the middle than near the outside edges. Now, I'm going to slow down here for this first real bit of Excel. This is Dr. Chesley's table. This is the location and the width on either side of that. So, to build that into a proper VLOOKUP table, so I can use the comma true version of VLOOKUP, I took each of these points and made it into 2 points in Excel. Started with a really small number, there's no impact there. The first impact occurs at 92,981 minus 1/2 of this width, and so on all the way down, so we can predict, depending on the location, whether there's an impact or not. Now, what we're going to do is we're just going to model where Bennu hits in 2135 to determine whether there's an impact or not. Now, one important thing, it's not just ran between the min and the max, it's the norm.inverse function. We send the ran function to that, and that determines the location where Bennu will hit, 371 in this particular case. We press calculate now, and 561, so somewhere out here. From there, we do a VLOOKUP into our table. Now, this VLOOKUP is a approximate match. In other words, it doesn't need to find the exact number, and it'll tell us whether there's an impact. Now, 1 in 2700, I would have to press calculate now 2700 times before I got the first hit. So, I'm going to run this 100,000 times. F5, I want to go to W. 100009. I'm going to hold down the Shift key when I press OK. That'll select all the way down to that range. Ctrl+Backspace to go to the top. Ctrl+D for down. And we've now run the model 100,000 times, throwing Bennu in a different location on its pass by Earth in 2135. How many times did it impact? Well, that's the sum of the 100,000 trials. What's the chance of impact? It's 100,000. Divided by the number of impacts, and I'm going to format that, Ctrl+1, custom, 1 in, and I'm going to get rid of all the decimals. So, look at that. Dr. Chesley said 1 in 2700, and this model, order of magnitude, is coming up with something close to that, which might just be dumb luck, because remember, it's a bad science alert. Now, I'm going to take this 100,000 trial model, and I'm going to run that 100 times. I'm going to do that using the data table in what-if analysis. So, here's my number that takes the result of this model, result of 100,000 calculations, and summarizes it down to one cell. I'm going to select 100 rows, data, what-if analysis, data table, the column input cell, because I have rand, it's just going to be any blank cell, click OK, and there are results. This takes a long time to calculate. I'm going to go into calculation options, and automatic except for data tables, which means that everything on the page will calculate except for this model here in gray. Now, what's the most number of times that it hit? There's our max function, one of the ingredients we had to use. In this particular case, 65 was the highest. I really like my statistic here with the 1 in 2273. So I'm going to cut, Ctrl X to put it next to the result, copy, paste, and then cut and back. Perfect. Time for the frequency function. Out of these 100 runs of the 100,000 row model, how many times did we get each of these bins? Now, the frequency function has to be entered in one more cell than you have bins. Let's use the function arguments. It wants to know the data array. The data array is these 100 results here, and the bins array are these bins. In order to get this to work, we have to press Ctrl+Shift+Enter. It's really frustrating when I click OK, they're going to press Enter. So I click up here in the formula bar, Ctrl+Shift+Enter. Boy, if there's a better way to do that, I would love to hear it. And we have our frequency of how many times each of these bins. It looks like the most likely is somewhere between 46 and 50. Again, I like this statistic. I'm going to adjust it here to deal with the division by zero error. Now our question is, after OSIRIS-REx does this perfect topographical mapping and understands the Yarkovsky effect, does that change these answers? To model that, I'm going to add two form controls here, and I'm going to use the scroll bars. I love the scroll bars because they create these great little sliders. I'll hold down the Alt key while I drag the slider, right click, format control. So for accuracy, I want to go from a minimum value of 1 to 25 times better, and we're going to put that answer in this cell, I10. Click OK. Then I want to copy this, paste, right click, format control. This one is going to go from a minimum value of 1 to a maximum value of 100, and it's going to be tied to this cell. Click OK. Dr. Chesley theorized that after OSIRIS-REx, the accuracy of the estimate, the uncertainty, would be reduced by a factor of 25. Let's go full on there. So now, the possible location for Bennu to hit is this very, very tiny area right there. Looked like the most likely occurrence before OSIRIS-REx was 1 in 2174. We're going to run this model again. All 10 million iterations, calculate now, and holy fireball, the odds of us getting hit are much, much higher, provided it stays right here at the mean. That's because there's some really wide keyholes near the mean. Now, we're going to improve the accuracy, which means how narrow it's going to be, but we're also going to potentially learn the true new mean, which is where our second control comes in here. This will shift us left or right. Alright, so there are spots out here where there really just are not a lot of keyholes. So if we learn that this is the location, and yes, I'm cherry picking, that that's the location that Bennu is going to hit, calculate now, and zero chance of hitting at all. Whew. Which is a great relief, because now we don't have to go hire a bunch of Hollywood oil rig drillers to go blow up Bennu. But maybe it doesn't hit there, maybe it hits here. We'll know all this by 2123 and really have a sense of whether we're in a lot of danger or hardly any danger at all. I love this model in Excel. We are doing every calculate now, 10 million calculations, but it is an amazing tool for calculating the variability of this asteroid. My sincere thanks to everyone on the OSIRIS-REx team who put up with my stupid non-science questions. Well, hey, again, I want to thank Soleil for this great idea of making 4-6 Excel YouTube creators create an Excel model with these 4 crazy items. Please watch others in the playlist. This is going to be hilarious. I'll put a link in the playlist down in the YouTube description down there. Then, when you're done, vote for your favorites. Again, a link down in the YouTube description. We're going to ask that you, if you watch the video, rate it from 1 to 5. Points. If you didn't want to choose NA, and those averages won't be included. To get to the survey, just point your phone at this barcode and choose open in browser. Hey, I want to thank you for stopping by. We'll see you next time for another netcast from Mr. Excel.